Welcome back, everyone, to the final day of Group Z, coming at you live from Paris. I am Eric Dolalonquist here with Christopher Monte Cristo Michaels and Joshua Jat Leisman. And of course, we're getting set for our next game, which is going to be H2K versus SK Telecom. Now, it's going to be interesting, guys, because Faker's out. Easy Hoon is in.
The Hoon is back. And, you know, I was taking a look at his solo queue. He's been playing a lot of Ryze, just like Faker has been. Orianna, Lulu, of course, his famous Azir. So probably going to see one of these four champions, if I had to guess.
Yeah, and I think the real story here is that Ryu doesn't get to play against Faker again. He only had the one chance to fill Faker. I actually think that's good for H2K, though, because watching that first game, it felt like H2K was more playing the game of kill Faker than the game called League of Legends.
That's the game that everybody's played against SK Telecom this tournament so far. And the one thing we've learned for sure is that it does not work. It's going to be interesting to see with Easy Hoon in how the priorities are going to shift around the map. But I just feel a little bit bad for Ryu, you know, denied that chance.
The thing that could be positive for you is that H2K looked a lot cleaner in their win earlier today, and they still have a fighting chance in this group. Obviously, it's not expected that they win this game against SKT. They're more looking forward to the EDG game, which is immediately after.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I mean, suddenly things are really, really big with Bangkok Titans actually nearly taking down EDG. It looked a little bit scary, so you got to wonder if H2K can maybe pull it off.
It has to be said, EDG is playing pretty poorly today. They really snagged that last game out of the fire. I mean, thankfully for them, they had the Braum Yasuo wall combo to deny a lot of the Jinx damage, but I'm not sure they could have come out on top if they didn't have those two champions. And EDG, or H2K rather, they're going to be pretty happy looking at that game moving forward for the rest of the day.
It was just about as close as it possibly could have gotten. It was like this much of a team fight away. There were like certain moments where I feel like if 007 had jumped on the right person at the right time, they could have maybe turned the fight around.
Absolutely. And it's also worth noting here that H2K played SKT closer than any other team has in this group. They were 20-plus minutes in, and H2K was still even in goal.
That's true. Well, guys, it's time to check out the starting lineups. You know them well by now, but let's check out H2K in the top lane. We've got Odo Omne, of course, down in the jungle. It is Lulex, the hometown hero. In mid, Ryu all the way from Korea, and then ADC, we have Hjarnan. And finally, down at support, it's Kassing. And at the coach position, it's Prawley.
God bless. On the red side, we have
Nailed
SK
it.
Telecom. Here we got. We got Marin in the top lane. Bengi in the jungle. Easy Hoon will be the mid laner, subbing in. First game at Worlds for him. Wolf is going to be the support for Bang, who is the AD carry.
That's right.
And that is the SK Telecom lineup.
We got it, man.
We are so good at this.
So good at this. High five. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Hope you guys heard that through the microphone. I am so ready for this match, man. I love watching Worlds. It's so good to see such interesting international competition. H2K, I kind of saw these guys a little bit backstage. They looked in much better moods. They were kind of, I got the vibe that they were thinking, you know, maybe we can actually get this done.
I mean, I'd be in a pretty great mood after seeing how EDG is playing today. If I'm H2K, there definitely is a window there. And we were talking a little bit about how closely they played SKT. Well, it was close. They were only down by about 1,000 gold. But even H2K as a team has a really tough time overcoming any deficit at all. Coming into Worlds, when they were down by 1,000 gold by 20 minutes, they were 1-9. So they really need to make sure that they have a strong 20 minutes if they want to close it out.
It's also worth noting that in the early game, they've been very strong. Their gold leads at 10 minutes rivaled and were better than Fnatic within the European LCS. Fnatic was undefeated. So it kind of goes to show you the difference in the mid-late game between those two teams. But it also kind of speaks to the chance of them being able to take a team by surprise, because when they're clicking, their early game is very good.
Yeah, you know, and I really wonder on the SKT side of things, how removing Faker, putting in Easy Hoon, I feel like this is going to push SK Telecom a little bit more towards the standard Korean type of play that we've seen from KT, from the Koo Tigers stylistically. Now, I'd assume SKT would be able to do that a little bit better, but it's going to be interesting to see if the styles change a lot, because we haven't seen this team with Easy Hoon in a while.
Yeah, and when they did play with Easy Hoon in the summer, it's worth noting that Bang played a lot of Vayne. They really try to move Bang onto more carry-oriented AD carries when Faker is out of the lineup, and have Easy Hoon move into a supporting role. So they've had a pretty distinct identity of playing with both Faker and with Easy Hoon. So we may see, maybe see the Vayne come out again.
And not to mention, we've already seen Marin completely carry in this tournament. He had the 1,500 gold lead against Amazing J in the first game today, and coming into that, he had the most gold of any top laner and any player in the tournament average per game. Of course, stats in this group were a little strange because we were thinking it was the Bangkok Titans that a lot of people were kind of running up the numbers on. But then we just saw BKT play EDG close, so it's Worlds, I guess.
Yeah, no kidding me. Marin had like 10 kill Darius games and things like that. He's really kind of stepped up. Sounds like we've got a little bit of a sound issue with Lulex, so they're getting that fixed on stage. And as soon as they do, we will move into the picks and bans. Going to swap out the headsets, it looks like.
Yeah. And people may be wondering, why take out Faker right now? But at this stage of the tournament, yeah, exactly, why not? You don't want to show anything that Faker has for the quarterfinals. He didn't really show a lot here in the group stages. I mean, even just blind picking Ryze, a little bit of a weird selection in their last match. So just keep him undercover right now. Don't allow people to understand what his champion pool is coming in.
Oh, yeah. He already revealed the Olaf, though, so I don't know. The secret's out, guys.
And for the most part as well, SKT is probably guaranteed first place in this group. It's not mathematically secured so far, but if they win against either H2K here or against the Bangkok Titans in the final game, they will be first. And also, even if they were to lose both of those games, they would still hold the tiebreaker over EDG. So the only way that they wouldn't get very first place, if H2K won both games against SKT and EDG, and SKT lost to Bangkok Titans, so there's really no need to try hard here for SKT.
You know, part of my brain says, well, obviously that's not going to happen. But then again, I was here for the last week of Worlds. I know what can happen in this tournament, so I'm not going to make any final judgments just yet.
Yeah, and also, to compound onto that, there would still be a tiebreaker between SKT and H2K,
yes,
should that occur. So they get even another chance to get out of this group in first place.
It's unlikely.
Well, not mathematically impossible, though.
No, not mathematically impossible. That's true. But like we know, math has never been my strong suit, so I'm not worried about it.
Yeah, so it's impossible.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah. That's Doha math, guys. So it looks like it's time to move into the champ select. Picks and bans for H2K versus SK Telecom. T1 Azir, our first ban of the day, followed by that Mordekaiser. I'm going to let Darnan have that one.
Yeah, you know, coming in here, the Azir ban is so common when you play against EZ Hoon because he is an incredible talent on that particular champion, so no surprise that they would go ahead and take that right out of the pool.
And Gangplank out of the way as well. Rek'Sai banned out for H2K. Final ban on blue side incoming. H2K does have a little bit more flexibility, a little bit more leeway in the bans being on the blue side. They're going to use it for the Elise.
Yeah, the Elise, I think, is a pretty smart choice, especially when you have Bengi in the lineup and he's more likely to be doing, you would expect, side lane ganks. Elise, the best turret diving jungler, especially early game. We got to see that, in the first game of the day with Marn and Bengi getting off some tremendous ganks, and they won't be nearly as potent with the Elise off the table.
Yeah, well, there's a Lulu ban, so I wonder, are we going to see the Darius first pick from H2K? If we don't, you can be sure SKT is going to grab it.
Well, what's interesting about SKT so far in this group stage is when they've been on red side, it's pretty much been Mordekaiser, Gangplank, Lulu for most of the games. They're just taking out power picks.
Yeah.
They haven't been sniping at one maybe pocket pick coming in. So that's, they're very confident in their ability just without the power picks down to seal the fate of their opponents.
This is what I call the Cloud Special if they lock this in, because it's not only Cloud 9, now it's Cloud Templar in Korea as well. Cloud oriented with Zamumu. It's true. Will they lock it in, though? Answer, probably not.
We've already seen Marin's Renekton against Darius, which will scare them away a little bit from picking Darius first.
Well,
because Singh looking to be a playmaker on Thresh. It was banned by SKT when SKT played them in the previous game.
Yeah, and the Lee Sin often taken out against H2K as well. They're going to have both champions up should they choose to go for it. We could see Bengi just try and deny that pick, but I have a feeling he's just going to play Rek'Sai.
Yeah, and as criticized as Lulex is as a jungler, he is a very good Lee Sin player. The move he pulled earlier today where he smited the minions while he was queuing, then kicked backwards from within the inhibitor turret, was really, really impressive. And had, in my opinion, had a more well-known player pulled off that play, it would have been a highlight clip on Reddit for the execution it was.
Well, maybe we'll still see that highlight. I'll upvote it instead.
Well, it's worth noting right now, as we see this Kalista lock-in, Bang is professionally undefeated on Kalista. He has never lost a game on this champion. No one lets him have it. No one lets SK Telecom have it, because how do SK Telecom win? Usually they win out of the strength of the laning phase, and that is not, and their control over Dragon, and that champion is perfect for both.
Well, the funny thing is that Bang actually got to play Kalista a little bit more often than some of the AD carries in Korea because of so many bans being targeted on Marin and on Faker, too.
The other thing with the SKT win rate statistics is, I think, Monty, you were mentioning, since the K and S teams merged, they have close to an 80% win rate as a team.
Yes.
So since Kalista was just released in this season, they're going to have a higher chance of being, yes, a very strong win rate for Bang. Of course, though, still undefeated, still impressive.
Okay. A little bit of a taste of Marathon Medicine as Renekton locked in by H2K. Interesting. But can they Renekton like Marin Renektons?
It's bold, I think, to pick SK like Telecom's counterpick into SK Telecom.
Mm-hmm.
I'm excited to see how it works out.
It challenges Marin's knowledge of the matchup. And I wonder how much knowledge Ottawamne has of that, because it really felt like when Marin had the lane as Renekton against Darius, he got that really slight lead from the early lane swap and then knew exactly how to punish it. I don't actually expect SKT to forfeit that lead to Ottawamne in the first place, so it will be a much more testing matchup, not to mention it feels like Marin's the one who kind of invented
it. All right, a little bit of a blast from the past as Bengi's going to be taking that Evelynn into the jungle. And Wolf on Alistar would not be a big shock, I suppose.
No, it's a really common Wolf champion.
Yep. For better or for Wolf. Depends on the day.
It's usually for better. He has an extraordinarily high win rate on Alistar. And the Evelynn pick, it's not something we've seen a whole ton of at Worlds, but I think it's still a very strong pick out of the jungle. Mm-hmm. It's still... Evelynn is always powerful as long as she's somewhat viable, just because you're never going to be able to track her very efficiently. It changes the way you have to ward on the map. So it adds an extra wrinkle of complexity to the way the enemy team has to play.
Yeah. Well, that Jinx pick wouldn't be bad for H2K to grab at this point, I would think. Jinx Thresh, a classic bot lane at this point.
Yeah.
But what is Ryu going to play? What does he dare bring against whatever Izzy it's going to play?
Yeah, he doesn't get to have the counterpick opportunity here. Izzy-Hoon, not Faker levels of counterpicking, where it feels like Faker has a counterpick to literally every champion in the game in mid lane.
Yeah.
But Ryu's going to have to be somewhat conservative here. Twist of Fate is actually a good pick. I feel like it used to be more of a risky matchup, but people have started rushing cooldown boots and home guards on him, so it almost gives him the capability to split almost any lane and keep the pressure at least somewhat adequate. So
it's,
I like that choice.
Yeah, TF.
Also, just great synergy. If we take a look at the side lanes here, there's going to be a ton of follow-up crowd control from Jinx and Thresh and Renekton. So he's got a lot of opportunities to really just chain the gold card into other forms of CC and pick up those kills. So what we could see Izzy-Hoon again play that Ryze. We just saw Faker play that matchup. No doubt they have shared their thoughts on that, even though it was a blind pick Ryze. Obviously, Faker doing quite well in that lane.
What about a Victor here?
Yeah, depends how much Izzy-Hoon has it. When we see him practicing, it doesn't seem like his favorite champion for the mid lane. That would be Lulu, but of course that has been taken away.
Right.
Azir's also been gone.
I mean, he had a lot of really good Cassiopeia games a while ago, but it's been a bit of time since Cassiopeia was meta, quote-unquote.
And will it be the Karthus?
Yes.
Oh, boy.
Oh, yes, it will. Karthus locked in for Izzy-Hoon. Now, this is a champion that we've seen him have very, very strong results on in the past, to say the least.
Wow, I love it. I think it's so interesting to pick this champion right now. Don't follow the Twisted Fate. Just stand in the mid lane, keep on farming, and just use your ult to follow up on that damage.
Yep.
So H2K, that is a very interesting problem to deal with.
SKT has now brought in two unique picks to the mid lane for Worlds. They're the only people to play Ryze. Faker's won with it twice, and Izzy-Hoon's the only Karthus thus far.
Olaf, checkmate.
three unique mid lane champions. I was thinking like overall champions.
Oh, yeah.
That's three in five games.
I'm pretty sure checkmate is exactly what Faker thought when he locked that Olaf in. He was like, boom, hard countered.
Yeah.
Well,
you know you're in trouble when someone has a counterpick ready for your mid lane Aurelia.
That's true. Well, you know you're in trouble when you're like picking Aurelia blind into the mid lane. I think that's your first sign of trouble right there. Well, guys, the Hoon has been unleashed. He's going to bring Karthus as the coaches shake hands. The game will get loading, and we are about to move right into it. I'm excited. I'm glad Izzy-Hoon's getting a chance to play.
Yeah. I'm also happy he's on a new champion here for Worlds, so it just extends the giant mid lane champion pool.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's an old Izzy-Hoon staple, though. If we think about Izzy-Hoon historically, loves these more zone control mages, and I'm excited to see him on it again.
That's right. So be sure to tweet your predictions to @LOLESports with the hashtag H2KWin or hashtag SKTWin, depending on who you think is going to take it. It's time to move out onto the Rift. And here we go. Our fourth game of the day here in our second day of the second week of group stages here at Worlds 2015.
Well, one thing I want to touch on with H2K is I thought their drafts throughout this group stage have all been very good. This is a great pick composition. They're trying to dissect SK Telecom's lane power. We talked about that. How do they get these leads? Just get the lanes ahead. And Odo Omne comes up with the counter pick that we saw Marin debut, and he has a Twisted Fate to come up there, chain that CC. So I think this is a very intelligent strategy by H2K against SKT.
And we even heard Prawley talking earlier as the coach and the person who puts together these drafts for H2K, that they like to play like SKT. They just know that they're not as clean as them at the execution. So it makes sense that they're picking kind of directly targeted at the way SKT plays. And it means the first 15 minutes of this game are just going to be even more important than they normally are in a League of Legends game.
And we talk about, of course, the Twisted Fate. That's also an easy Hoon champion. So when you can't deny it, it could have very easily come in for SK Telecom, too, as the last pick. So yeah, grabbing it early, Ryu feeling confident in this part of the draft.
But definitely. I think you're getting some deep wards down. It's mostly been a fan for a little while, although H2K grouping up down to the top path. Meanwhile, some action on the mid lane. Ryu getting caught, gets exhausted, can have to flash right into Bengi for the damage. Bang loading some on as well. Ryu doesn't get away. First blood goes to Bang. And I can't think of any other word for that than disaster.
Correct. That is, he had boots as well because he was hoping to have a little bit more mobility in that leaning phase to dodge Karthus defiles. But he was really just trying to deny, I think, Karthus taking some small raptors over the wall for a slight experience advantage. He ends up giving him assist and burning both of his summoner spells.
That is
awful. Right there, just a disaster for Ryu.
And that's not what you need on Twisted Fate. To survive the early laning phase, you need to hold that teleport usually to get a second Doran's Ring or start building up into some items. So now he's just going to fall behind and get pushed in. And this is really going to set the tempo on the mid lane in a very big way.
I think so. Wolf and Bang, now with a bit of a lead early on. They haven't gone back and spent that money yet, obviously, but it's something that H2K is going to definitely be worried about.
Also, having no flash on Twisted Fate, Karthus can absolutely choose to fall back to his turret, and we still have a flash on Bengi here. There's a lot of kill pressure in the mid lane steal, even though Easy Hoon burned both of his summoners.
And I'm actually interested to see the way Easy Hoon plays this lane as well, because if Karthus actually gets the wave frozen near his turret, he has tremendous gank assistance, because all he'd have to do is place the wall on Ryu, which has really long range to get the slow foreign Eve coming in, who still has flash, and they could actually get some pretty easy gank kills on that side. Be interesting to see how that lane plays out.
Yeah.
Really fast chilling smite onto Bengi with that first recall right at 3 minutes, so he'll be looking for some opportunities. We'll see if he chooses to go ahead and farm it out or whether he wants to try and make some plays.
Yeah, that was another big thing about that level one kill on Ryu, is that it gave four members of SK Telecom assists too, so a little bit extra gold in the pocket early on is so important.
One thing that we've seen about SKT is, especially the games against CDG, they take one mistake like that and they just turn it into a win. They are absolutely unforgiving. They seem to be prepared for every possible scenario, playing their team compositions very well around these disadvantages. See if they can do the same thing here.
Yeah, and the one lane that is the most uninfluenced by the death of Ryu in the early game was the top lane of Odo Omne and Marin, because Marin didn't even pick up an assist despite kind of being down there for the initial engagement. This is actually the spot where the lane wants to be frozen for the gank we just talked about, where Easy Hoon would just have to put his wall down. Ryu knows it's a possibility, and Lulex will end up scouting it out for him.
Yep.
I think this is really smart by Lulex. You have to start getting some information
still
here.
Still hasn't seen him, though.
Hasn't detected that, but does get the ward down on the Raptors. Now they know Lulex is coming around. They're going to try and make a play on this.
Yeah, ward thrown in. Lulex actually doing quite a bit of damage to Mengi early on. Here comes Easy Hoon, though. The damage onto Lulex is scary. There's the flash. Lulex slowed down by the wall. Tries to avoid a gold card onto Easy Hoon, but here comes Marin as well. Flash from Bengi. I don't think that's going to be enough damage. Oh, and Bengi taken out by Ryu. Although Easy Hoon, with the answering kill, will keep the kill lead ahead for SKT.
That
meanwhile, down the bot
worse.
Lane, things get crazy. And Jarnan taking a lot of damage. Will he actually lift this? He actually went back up. That
it's
is so brave, dude. SKT, Wolf very low. Zol has him with that. There's the Q. Bang gets the kill. And now Kessing is in a little bit of trouble, too. Exhaust Wolf, unafraid of the Thresh. Flash of the Brush. He grabs Bang, goes back in for the Flay. Doesn't have the cooldown. Kessing goes down, too. Bang with the kill. That's three already for him in 5 minutes. It's looking bad for H2K.
That's a nice way to put it.
It's gone from bad to worse. We said level one was disaster. What is much worse than disaster? Catastrophe, maybe?
Apocalypse?
The thing is for H2K, this game is a bit of a gimme. They weren't expected to win, and it actually doesn't matter for them as far as advancing out of the group, because regardless of the results here, they still need to beat EDG to move out of this group. So we saw the mid lane play, the way this bottom lane play begun, was actually kind of encouraging for HTK because they got Wolf low, but Yharnam just wasn't expecting this Q to land. He had heal when that landed from Bang, so Bang surprised him with damage, and once that happened, when your AD carry dies with heal still up, you're asking yourselves to get double killed.
Absolutely, man. I mean, you can't keep going up against a Kalista like that with that low health.
Look at this. He's coming back into lane too with the Cutlass and a dagger already completed, so a huge advantage in that bottom lane for Bang. And Wolf is playing this patiently, and we've got to start thinking about reused teleports right now. Now, they still can save this game. It's not so far gone yet, but it's going to come down to whether they can actually secure kills in the side lanes. And with EasyHoon, he's turned around the lane. You can see he's very actively pressuring it. This is where you bottle up that Twisted Fate.
Yeah, if they can manage to take down that mid lane turret before Ryu is able to get anything done with his first ult or two, that's going to be really tough thing for H2K to overcome.
And I do have to echo, that is the main way H2K would have any shot back in this game. Which is why the Karthus pick is quite wise. He can keep the wave shoved up, which makes it easy to punish when Twisted Fate does leave lane. And he can also kind of answer just with his Rec Room. Once he knows all the threats have left that lane, he could stand and basically use it immediately as the TF comes in for a little bit of an equalizer.
And that's up now. So it's yet another thing that Sharn in the bottom lane really needs to be aware of. I mean, we saw him kind of be risky with low health situations before. You can't do that with a level 6 Karthus on the field.
Now it does make it considerably more challenging. See, Marit, interestingly, he's playing out the matchup. Both of our top laners double Doran's Blade, so they're not rushing into any of their items. And playing the Darius a little bit more defensively this time around.
It's the closest matchup we've seen from Marin against an opponent, is the way Ottawan has been able to play him. This is the counterpick that Marin selected for him, essentially, earlier on in the week. And I like the way Renekton plays in this matchup, because I feel like he has a lot of tools to get inside the Q range of Darius to not take the maximum damage, stun, get his damage out, and then also dice out afterwards. It's a clever pick, and I think Ottawamna is playing it pretty properly, but without an early jump and experience, the lane is still somewhat splitting.
Yeah, even though the slice and dice is just that small little dash, it's enough to get inside and land that W so you can get that efficient trade.
It seems like it'd be kind of scary for H2K, right? Even when you have Renekton teleporting in later on, I mean, you've got a lot of reasons to not want to be in melee range of SK Pelican.
Absolutely. Scary. Very much H2K picked this game for the laning phase, so if the laning phase falls apart, they're in even more trouble.
Oh, and Here we go. Marin's TP is back up, just as a reminder, was down for a little bit, and now Wolf and Bengi just here to zone out the enemy dual lane and try and finish off this
even
tower
Karthus
early.
Is rolling down.
There it is. Requiem coming in. Teleport coming into that turret. The bot lane as well, too. Wolf gets stopped up for a second. Darnan stays alive for the moment. Had to use not the summoner hero quite yet. Bengi getting taken out by Ryu as he joins the fight. Ottawamna making a big difference so far in this one. Nice explosive cask. Have they separated EasyHoon enough? Doesn't look like it. There's the flash from EasyHoon. Oh, they're re-engaged. Can Bang do enough damage to turn this one around? Nearly. Marin teleports in. He is ready to go. Lulex taking a lot of damage. Doesn't die from the ult, but there's another kill for Bang. And they manage to trade it barely evenly in the end.
And Bang gets double buffs after that. Now, what SK Telecom did, they were overly aggressive on that tower right now. Marin, this was a problem I said early in the tournament, maybe a little bit late on these TPs, but they back them into a choke point where their AoE can be effective, and then that's when the TP comes in. H2K really over-pursuing that one, and now Bang is even more of a problem than he was before. He's up 32 CS, 4-0 with double buffs.
Well, you did mention Bang having more successful games when Faker is out of the lineup and more team focus going towards that bottom lane, and I do actually have to say that the bottom lane gank there by SKT was not very clean. I kind of disagree with the Karthus roaming down so early because the Twisted Fate is naturally going to match that. You can use your Requiem from lane and then punish once the teleport comes in from the Twisted Fate. Even then, H2K does come in with Otawamne. Darius was biding his time because SKT probably didn't think they needed him. And at the end of the day, it was a one-for-one trade. It's just the leads SKT had beforehand were huge.
Well, killing smart on Otawamne there. Bengi has to flash away as Ryu comes in, gets knocked up. The disengage just for SKT. Lulex pulled into turret range.
No.
Wolf is going to push Lulex farther into turret range. More damage onto him. Will he survive? Wolf just needs one more hit, basically. Marin flashes in, missed the Q, but got the auto, and there's going to be a pause. Another kill for SKT.
Yeah, I wonder if people are pausing for the Darius interaction there. It is possible to channel your Q. It's a 0.75 second cast time and then flash and have the damage execute.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of players missing that play. I wonder if this is a pause just as a suspected bug to check that out. But
you know, to me,
either
it
way
looked like he got a little bit too close. Like he had him on the inside range of the Q, maybe?
It looked to me like it didn't do any damage. So
yeah, well, the inside ring of the Q
doesn't do a whole lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enemies hit by the handle do take 50% damage and do not get a bleed stack. But I've seen that a couple times looking like it doesn't do any damage as well.
Well, we'll see what happens here.
We'll hear what the pause was actually for. I'm purely speculating here.
I mean, in the end, they got the kill. 6-2 right now for SK Telecom, so things still going fairly as well as you can see from the scoreboard down at the bottom.
Yeah, I just received word that it has nothing to do with the Darius. It's actually Otawamne pausing because he thinks he encountered a bug. He says he stunned Evelynn, but it didn't apply. So they're checking to see if that's the case.
Okay.
It's totally valid for a player to pause whenever they suspect a bug.
Yeah, absolutely, and they should as well, too. I mean, if you have a bug and you don't pause and you get punished for it, it kind of ends up being on you in the end, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
I see we're back to the wave, the pause wave here in Paris.
The French crowd loves the wave.
Yeah, this can go on for a while. They did this for 5 minutes in the middle of a game.
I've said this before, and it's still true in week two. The enthusiasm of this French crowd is like some of the biggest I think I've ever seen in LoL.
Yeah, a lot of it is obviously the crowd and the culture, but the casters that are able to encourage us, the team that Chips and Wah have put together here for casting,
really
adds so much energy to this entire venue as well as their own broadcast.
Yeah, I got to hang out with those guys a little bit last week, and they have a great studio here in Paris and a pretty big following, and for a good reason, too. Fantastic casters.
Has the wave stopped already? That's,
there it goes. Okay, well.
Please, Jad. They're not going to stop.
Come on. Is the moon gone? As long as the moon is around, there will be waves, right? That's science.
It's coming back. Anytime you want to join in, it's coming our way.
That's on the other side, though. Oh, all right.
Yeah, that was...
There we go.
That was weak, Noah.
You'll just have to take our word for it.
We did it very enthusiastically.
We're North Americans, so we can't be expected to be quite as enthusiastic.
And I'm from a German community in Wisconsin, so the enthusiasm...
You're stoic.
That's right. Yeah, you know me. Stoic Noah. That's what they call me.
We'll change your name to Stoa next season.
Stoa. Stoic? Nah.
This game in particular, it's especially with this gank going pear-shaped in the top lane for H2K, is getting a little bit worse.
Yeah. I never got that, going pear-shaped. Why are pears are good? They're healthy for you? They taste
it's not. It's usually not considered an attractive look on a woman, though.
Oh, I see.
Maybe I'm using that analogy all wrong. Like sometimes I use analogies, and then I realize long after using them.
I don't know.
Like
maybe you were using
we're in right. France, for instance.
Okay.
I did take French in high school, but when I was a child between the ages of like 5 and 12, when people would say, c'est la vie, I would be like, I guess la vie is just what you say when things aren't going the right way. Like, la vie. And then I realized it was actually a proper French phrase.
Spilled my Mountain Dew. Oh, la vie.
La vie.
La vie. Oh, well. Yeah. I don't know.
It's important to research these sayings.
I think so, too.
I might remove pear shape from my casting.
Maybe. Unleash the SJWs. I can't read that. You know, usually I can't read the signs because they're Korean. This is like a whole other level.
Hey, somebody's excited about being Canadian. Are you excited about being Canadian?
I'm always excited about being Canadian. I was born in the USA, but I have dual citizenship.
Wow.
And I'm very happy to have books.
Have you been to a hockey game?
Yeah.
Me too.
I used to film WHL hockey games in my hometown.
Really?
And then I also went to an Oilers game when I went to school in Edmonton. So.
I used to be involved in the broadcast for the NCAA hockey in my city, too.
Awesome.
What do you know? We're hockey broadcasting, buddy.
We're bonding
wow.
after this pause time.
We are. You're getting to hear us bond in real time. That's amazing. Well, the pause is still ongoing. They're saying Hoon right now. For Hoon! The Hoon. I don't know what's going on. Well,
we're in a pause, and the French casters are being very entertaining.
Yep.
Got a step of our game. Talking about hockey.
So. We're not going out to the audience, so this is a nice, chill.
See, this is strange.
Kind of conversation.
Well, see, this is what it's like for Monty and I most of the time, Jeff, is that the audience that we're speaking to isn't in the same studio as us usually. So we don't really get any feedback.
I think it's a much more relaxing tone because you don't really need to worry that there's all these people just sitting in the audience waiting to react to what you're doing, just kind of bored. But people just get to listen in. They still get to see the venue being excited.
You just pretend that the crowd is laughing at all your jokes instead. Makes it a lot easier.
Look at how excited they got over that last thing you said, Monty.
They're like, you're right. We love your jokes, Monty Cristo. They're the best.
No, they're not. Even I can admit that.
You're right. Well, guys, while we look into the issue on stage, we're going to send it right over to the analyst desk for their take on this game so far.
We do have some time while they deliberate. Based on the information that they have, our QC is going to be looking at the logs, figuring out what needs to be done in reference to the proposed stun or the supposed stun that did not happen. With this time, though, that we have, I think we should talk about the game as it is currently playing out. SKT with a pretty significant advantage, most of that advantage resting on Bang so far in the game.
For sure. Like, the double kill in the bottom, the mistake from Yarnan was massive, not flashing, not healing. It was rough, that double kill.
Yeah, it certainly was, and it shows, like, there's a kind of disparity, and we've seen it in the past, but it's not until you're against a great bottom lane. The difference between Hyunin and Kassing, Kassing is so much of a presence in that lane, and when you focus him, he gets a lot of outplays, but they went on Hyunin then, and he backed away very early, mistimed the flash, mistimed the heal, and Kassing still nearly outplayed it by himself, but just wasn't able to get it done.
You're a veteran of the bottom lane, Tabe. In those scenarios, you know, I think typically people, you know, say that the support dictates the lane. Your opinion of Kassing and the way that he's played so far this tournament?
I think, how do I pronounce his AD?
Hyunin.
I think Hyunin has a huge mistake of not using double summoners when they're engaging with their enemies. But I think even they use the summoners, they still, it's not an, they can't beat Kalista because Jinx and Kalista is always loose. Jinx is only good at late game, and Kalista is super good at early stage. But I think why SKT is leading so much now is because of the huge play of Wolf. He has multi-target pulverize, and he saves the team.
Wolf's been coming up big. There's no doubt about that.
Like, the other thing we're talking about is why do you blind pick Thresh? Like, Kassing is a great Thresh, but Wolf's Alistar Van is like second to none. He showed it at MSI. He's showing it again this game. He is just able to set up so much, and his knowledge of how much damage he can take with and without ultimate just creates all of these baits. You saw it in the big turret dive down bottom lane. He had his flash still, like, just absolutely no hesitation on baiting the whole team into that brush.
It's like, what I want to see is more Janna. I want to see Janna blind picks because it's so good against this Braum that everyone's picking, good against the Alistar as well. And if people start picking Janna, we might see a Soraka, we might see a Nami, and that's interesting to me. New supports coming in.
I would love to see the kind of the rock, paper, scissors of support and the bot lane come into play. Something else I want to look at is that top lane, though, because the last time we saw the Darius and Renekton matchup, Marn was on the other side of it, and he was absolutely throwing the hammer down as Renekton. We switch it up this time. He's playing Darius. He's going even in CS, no problem.
Yeah, and this is something that I like to hit on top laners, is he changed the tempo of top lane by investing in a second Doran's Blade. And what that does is it actually slows down the Renekton because he can't get the auto attack reset out of that Tiamat, and he can't really do it. He can still win trades, Renekton, but not to the same extent. and Darius gets that little bit tankier, which means he can live through the lane, he can lifesteal up and, I guess, at least trade relatively effectively. And I think that's really smart from Aaron, showing that he knows exactly how to use items to his advantage as well as a way of manipulation.
But I have something to say, because we know that Renekton is really counterpicking Darius, but on the other side, we can see that they have SKT picking Karthus and picking Eve. Eve is really effective for early threats, even though maybe he's just ganking mid, but before Eve is appearing on the map, maybe Renekton is really have a hard time because he didn't know where is Eve. Mm. And when Karthus is level 6, he can't have a match too.
Yeah, he can't ever push up the lane because of that inherent pressure that Eve does provide.
Right. Lots of early game and global pressure supplied by the Evelynn and the Karthus. So let's move on to that Karthus pick, right? Karthus in the mid lane. SKT's been pulling out a lot of unique picks that no other team has played yet. And we had the Ryze, as Jat mentioned in the pregame, as well as the Karthus now. Olaf from the mid lane, you know, this is a team that clearly has a lot of tricks up their sleeves. And the question is, how many more do they have?
I think it's funny that Izzy-Hoon comes back with the card. It's as if they kind of froze him down and then, like, crack the ice and then he's back. Comes back with the card as the Azerban came in, which he's known for, I guess. But I think the card was interesting just because of the point that Tabe highlighted. But it's also important that it was something that I want to touch on, like, with the matchup Renekton-Darius. I haven't seen a lot of it since the changes, but I think our opinion of it might be a bit skewed because in this particular game, EDG versus SKT, we need to keep in mind that Amazing J got really screwed over by the lane swap. He got into a lane that I was pushing out and he lost a lot of CS because of that.
That is a very good point. I just want to quickly remind the viewers at home, the reason we are at the analyst desk right now is because there's a pause on stage due to a supposed bug. Odawame claiming that he was supposed to have stunned Bangi in that engagement. It didn't go off. So again, they're looking into the logs, trying to figure out whether or not any of that actually went through, and if it did not happen, deliberating as to whether or not a remake should be offered. As that happens, we have some time to continue to talk about the game. On the side of H2K, given the way that the game has played out so far, right, they're about 3K, 3.5K down, pretty significant number at this stage in the game. What is going to be their ticket back into this game, if anything?
I think that's really hard to dictate just because of how far ahead the Kalista is. I would have said that the late game scaling of Jinx when she gets three items should be a recipe to be able to do that, and they should be able to funnel the TF into that lane to really help lock that down. The problem is that he's got like Berserker Greaves pickaxe versus a completed Blade of the Ruined King, which just means that trading becomes nearly impossible in that lane. So if they are going to get back into the game, it would be through the late gaming, I guess, team fight that Jinx can bring with all those AoE rockets, but against a Fed Bang, like, that is very difficult.
Tall task, to say the least, especially when you have something like a Renekton where you're looking to put the pressure on early, not necessarily to rest on your laurels into the late game. You know, moving away from this game, though, since we have the time, looking at these two teams in the tournament, currently, H2K, there's not a ton of pressure on this game because, as Jat also mentioned, victory here doesn't secure them moving on. The more important game is looking ahead to EDG. So I actually want to take a moment and talk about this team and the preparation that they need to be doing for a matchup against Edward Gaming.
I feel like if we take this game they're currently in, it kind of shows that H2K has a very smart draft. I think the TF blind pick into the Evelynn was smart, and it shows that they can adapt. EDG have not shown any kind of signs of adaptation in a pick and ban. They kind of just don't look at the other side of the pick and ban at all and just pick their champions. And I think that is H2K's like kind of key to kind of open up the lock to EDG.
I have to mention that because we have put so much emphasis on the top laner, Amazing J, today, and after the game when BKT and H2K, when H2K wins, I hear that from the interview from Shox that Abdulwamne said that AJ has a lot of mistakes and it is his job to exploit him. That means I think it is really important to when someone says he is very confident in winning the lane. So I think what do you guys think about the matchup against Amazing J and Odawame?
Yeah, I actually think that that is the case, that Odawame is going to look to do that. And I think that, once again, SKT have given them some tools. Clearlove is a very good Evelynn player. If that is what is keeping this lane matchup down right now, and they can use that to capitalize and maybe overcommit on Amazing J, there is potential there. But right now, H2K, the strength in the top lane and the disparity in the bottom lane is actually the way that EDG likes to play because of how strong Mako and Deft is. So they need to be very aware of where they are focusing resources, because once again, you can't let AD carries like Deft, like Bang, get these huge leads.
My curiosity would be whether or not H2K adopts a similar style to Bangkok Titans, which is put something hyper-aggressive, put Lulex on Lee Sin, right? We know him as a Lee Sin player. Put him on something aggressive in the early game, as well as laners that have extraordinary gank assistance. Secure yourself a couple early kills in the first, 10 minutes of the game so that you can take over fights when it comes to the Dragon, which is where EDG does fall into large engagements, and they follow through on them entirely, whether or not they're on the losing or winning end of them.
I've said this the whole time. Running gun style League of Legends against Chinese teams is very good, because if the game is equal, no, regardless of team comps, the Chinese teams will fight you. They cannot give up objectives. It's like against their DNA or something. So exactly what we saw in that SKT game where they just went hard commit. They will continue to do that if you pick early game against them.
And also it's kind of perfect because Kassing is also known as the trash player. And I think he's the kind of guy that can impact the map the way, same way Moss did in that game. And like speaking of Odoamne, coming into the tournament, I saw him as a weakness. I saw Lulex as a weakness. But I think Odoamne has played in this tournament better than he has all split long. So that is very important to highlight.
Upside for them there, especially considering the meta as of right now.
But other than Amazing J that I mentioned a lot today, I think EDG's bot lane is far better than H2K's bot lane. We can see that just now, the bad execution of the ADC Jinx. I think there will be a really hard time for... to against Deft.
Yeah, I completely agree with that, especially if Deft wants to continue to play these aggressive picks like the Kalista, like Lucian. He has shown that he will play a bully in the bottom lane and not let the other AD carry scale. And it's bit him a couple of times because they have fallen a little bit behind. But if that goes right for you, you just means that you explode through the mid-game team fight much earlier.
Now, let's return to this game for a brief moment. Going back through the picks and bans, we see, again, a very interesting combination of, well, if Kalista is the one that's getting out of control, is there not a way for H2K to deal with that, given the TF and the Renekton being able to get in, stun up on Kalista and keep her in place, deal enough damage to get her?
I feel like, personally, the matchup, like Jinx, Thresh into the Kalista, Alistar, is just such a polarized matchup that you can't really judge like based off of play. While we know Yharnam misplayed in that particular engagement, there was just no way for them to win that fight. I feel like the Jinx was kind of way too confident to pick. Like, you have to keep in mind consistency. Maybe they wanted the lane swap, maybe they had some other idea in mind, but that is like a gamble. And I feel like they should have just went for a safer pick because the Kalista came in early from SKT, and maybe they should have went for the Corki, first Corki of the tournament.
And the other thing you have to remember against Kalista is she has one of the easiest itemizations into third item QSS out of all AD carries because of the double attack speed and lifesteal without having to go into it. And because of the delayed item purchases of the Renekton, he had to go a second Duran's Blade, he's not going to get armor for an extended period of time. So there is a potential for Kalista to itemize much easier towards a QSS before she picks up that last Whisper, and it can set up the team fight in their favor.
Afforded a lot of leniency there. Also, too, if we look at picks and bans, Jat mentioned this as well, or perhaps Monty. They mentioned the fact that SKT has been banning essentially the same three champions every single game when they're on red side, which is indicative of the fact that they know that they can outplay a team as long as they remove the power picks from the table. So again, they're not having to show too much. They're not being forced to show too much in that regard, yet they're coming out with these unique champion picks and saying, we've got everything covered. There's, you know, they're looking more and more like a heavy favorite, even though they are not necessarily in the strongest group in terms of depth.
Yeah, my opinion is that SAT have shown one thing in this group stage, and it's that they are currently the best team in the world. Like, it is up to other people to beat SKT. They have given absolutely nothing away at this point.
It's like what I feel if I take a look at SKT. The information they've given us just makes it harder to prepare. It's like, what are you going to do about the Renekton Darius? Like, we've seen teams there just hesitate to pick Darius against SKT. That is just a massive advantage.
He plays Malphite. You can't pick Fiora. There are so many things right now that SKT have just said, we don't care about the meta. Yeah. We will beat you.
Now, Tabe, when you look at a team like this, we're looking at SKT in their current form, and you as a team are going to have to go up against them in a best of five group stage or bracket stage following this. What would be your approach to a team like this that seems to have so many different formulas for success?
Because just like Yamato just said, it is very hard for us to prepare to against a team with so deep in the champion pool. Mm. So I think what we have to do is we have to bring something that we are very good at. For example, just like you said, they are mispicking Jinx just now, right? Mm. But I suddenly think of that. Why they're picking? Because they are learning from Flash Wolves. You remember yesterday's game? Flash Wolves have 3 games with Jinx and they have Flash 2 and Morgana. I think simply it is because HTK is learning from different opponents. So I think the team that maybe can win SKT, maybe I will give a vote for Flash Wolves, because if they are too confident from SKT of not banning out their Lulu, LeBlanc and their Jinx, maybe they will suffer a lot.
All right, well, there we go. We're throwing it back to the game right now as we're into it. Take it over, guys.
Thanks, and I just want to clear this up real quick because I've been talking to production during this whole pause, and the way the ruling happened, we are continuing to play the game. What happened was Ottawamne went to stun Bengi's Evelynn as Bengi was flashing away. The reason it paused is because it did not stun him after the flash. That is a bug and was confirmed as a bug. However, after the flash, no H2K players were in range to reach Bengi, so the referees are not allowing a remake or not offering a remake for that stun because they do not think it had a meaningful impact on the game.
Yeah, Lulex was close, but all his abilities were on cooldown and his flash had already been used.
Yeah, we also watched the clip many, many times to try and come to our own conclusions, and it didn't seem like Bengi was going to die or even take damage if this stun had landed.
Well, yeah, the only other person nearby you could say was Ryu. He was knocked up and still out of range of clicking for that glow card anyway, so no chance there as well. Meanwhile, Bang will take the first dragon of the game for SK Telecom. As we get back into the action between H2K and SKT, here in our fourth game of the day.
And there we go.
There we go.
There we go. Bengi
back in the game.
Coming out on the side.
And Ryu slowed down. He's taking a lot of damage here. Could be in trouble. No flash for him. Gets very low red card thrown out, but Wolf comes in for a bit of bloodthirsty support kill stealing. That's how I like to come back from a pause.
Full combo, killing with the Alistair. Oh, this is looking like SKT 4,000 gold up. We also had a brief discussion during the pause about whether or not H2K would even want this remake because it's so hard for them to beat SKT and they need to be able to keep their morale high for the next game against EDG. It's going to be an unfortunate thing for them that they have to come back from potentially getting beaten down pretty hard from SKT here and have the group-defining game against EDG.
Yeah. And meanwhile, Bengi and Wolf able to get into the enemy jungle now, take care of some wards, throw down some of their own. Don't find that one. Nope, now they do. And this is kind of what I thought we'd see a little bit more of with EZ moving in now. We're going to see maybe a little bit more room for Wolf and Bengi to play a little bit more like Score and Peekaboo. Get into the enemy jungle, throw down a lot of wards, get more vision control than we maybe see SK Telecom prioritize in other games.
The funny thing about that is Izuhun is doing exceptionally well in lane.
Yeah.
So much of that is because Ryu burned both summoner spells at level 1. But it's not like Izuhun is sitting back and being non-aggressive.
Baron could be in trouble. Gold card lands, and I don't think there's any escape for him. Ryu with another kill. Meanwhile, some action down in the bot jungle. SKT steals the red.
And that's the gank that we were talking about to start off this game. That is such a great kill lane for H2K. Already has that Tiamat, a lot of damage coming out, and you can just chain stun into stun very easily. So Marin, I think, playing a little bit disrespectfully right here. We'll see what SKT can get for it. They are going to potentially punish this movement, but they're not. Ryu's right back in the lane, gets that red card. Ottawamne is going to get some turret damage down as well.
Yeah, Ottawamne getting a lot of damage done on that tier 1 turret up in top lane, and he may actually be able to take that out. In fact, I think he will.
It's absolutely huge.
The more ganks like that Ryu can get, the better. This injection of gold is actually pretty good for H2K in the grand scheme of the game. Despite all the bad things that have happened for them, 3,000 gold at 14 minutes is not insurmountable by any means, especially if Twisted Fate can get off good ganks without being punished.
Well, Ryu's stayed relevant. I mean, yeah, he's died 3 times, but he's also gotten 3 kills. He's way down in farm in lane, but if he can start making more of these ganks, maybe they could turn it around. Still a tall order, but they're doing what they need to do at this point anyway.
Definitely bouncing back in QSS second now for Bang.
Why not?
I mean, when you get this far ahead, that's a great question. Why not? Okay, well, you can QSS Hook, you can QSS the Renekton Stun, you can QSS Gold Card.
There's a lot of CC to worry about.
And because he has so much more money, it basically doesn't matter. I mean, he's up against a Jinx with a pickaxe and Berserker Greaves.
Yeah, the reason you wouldn't want to go QSS second item under normal circumstances is it puts you so behind the damage curve of the opponent AD carry. Hjarnan is sitting on enough gold to get a BF sword right now, but not even finish his Infinity Edge. Bang will maintain his lead. He has more than a QSS worth of gold ahead of him, so he still has better offensive capabilities as well as not being able to get stunned for duration by TF now.
Yeah, to put that in perspective, right now Bang is about 2,000 gold up on Hjarnan, so that's what's making it work.
Well, when you get first blood, three more kills after that, it helps quite a bit. Meanwhile, some action to EZ-Yun in the mid lane, gets flayed in. Nice explosive cast. EZ-Yun in a lot of trouble. He's going to get taken out easily, and that is yet another kill for Ryu. The ganks are starting to happen for H2K.
Well, that's what this composition does. They are very good at making picks with this composition. See, Marin, ahead, missing that apprehend, but they do take down that tower in the top lane in response. You have to be very careful, and they
here's the dive.
Good pressure by H2K. They're trying to fight back. Marn, 1v4 under the turret.
Yeah, gold card's going to lock him up, and that's all H2K needs for an easy kill. Hjarnan getting that one. A little bit of damage on the turret besides.
Two plays in a row, extremely crisply executed. If they can continue this rotation, it will be extremely impressive. Kill in mid, kill in bottom lane. Ryu used his teleport because he wants to save the mid lane turret, and he actually does. H2K is just destroying these last few minutes of the game.
Yeah, they're going to get another turret here too. Hjarnan in this minigun form, and the play on the map has been pretty darn good for H2K. Playing this composition out beautifully, and this is a tough road to hoe for SKT because they don't really have a lot of siege here. They have a Kalista and a melee Darius and a relatively short-range Karthus to try and punish this mid lane turret. The wave clear's there for H2K.
It's extremely hard to push against a Twisted Fate, especially one that has cooldown boots with home guard. Even if he needs to go back, he can get back to the lane as quickly as possible. And if it wasn't for H2K having all those pretty big missteps early in the game, their execution in the last 3 minutes would have been enough to actually pull them ahead of SKT. This is very promising for H2K as they look forward in this group, even if they don't win this game.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the pause seems to help them get their heads on a little bit straighter here. The cohesion looks much better since the pause has ended. Wolf tries to make a play there on Alulix, doesn't quite connect. That turret's starting to take a little bit of damage. Now Dragon up in 20 seconds, too.
Ryu actually getting the Lich Bane first here, so prioritizing some burst in the ganks, as well as an opportunity to split push, because it's going to be difficult, especially with that teleport on EZ-Yun, to follow him up. So maybe looking for some more tower pressure here. And when you're behind, you need to just make those man-up plays. Go somewhere else, try and beat them 3v2, 2v1, something like that with a bit of burst from the Lich Bane, or just split push and don't fight them until you get back into the gold game.
Yeah, SKT gets an unopposed second dragon, and if they can keep this up, that's going to be cause for concern for H2K a little bit later. And I mean, how many times have we seen this in Korea, giving up a turret here and there, focusing on those dragons and coming out with that big advantage in the mid and late game? Oh, Bang loads up. Wolf goes in, there's a knockup on Hjarnan, pushes him back out from under turret. Looks like a solid gank for SKT as Bang grabs another one. Meanwhile, Ryu with the 1v1 on EZ-Yun, 1v1 on each side.
Two plays were happening at the same time right there. They traded flashes in the mid lane to get that kill. Bottom lane, they kind of traded flashes as well. Now it's all about the turret push. Trading an inner turret for an outer turret, though, is always an advantageous move.
Yeah, we'll see how far they want to push it, though. Looks like they may be collapsing up through the mid side, just pulling back, not going for an inhibitor turret quite yet.
Now they could take the red buff here on their way out, so it's jungle control, if nothing else.
That was a great call from SKT, too, because they saw the Destiny go up, and then they immediately knew that the TF wasn't going to the bottom side, and they could go ahead and make that play.
Yeah, let's check this one out again. Pretty easy gank onto EZ, and looks like Odo Omne helping out a little bit there as well. And Ryu with the flash gold card. Yeah. A little bit of revenge.
So they ended up burning more on that gank than SKT burned on the gank in the bottom side, but they still did convert another kill onto EZ-Yun.
And not only that, but the effect is too, as soon as H2K backs, SKT walks up into the mid side, gets another turret, but still, you know, trading blow for blow a little bit, but SKT taking now incremental advantages after falling a little bit behind in the pressure game.
I feel like this is a little bit of what we saw in the first meeting between H2K and SK Telecom, where they managed to keep it fairly close in the early game, and although we had some weird stuff happen in this game, they made up for it. They made it close enough, but now, just like in game one between these two teams, SK Telecom starting to jump ahead a little bit every few minutes.
Question now becomes, how is H2K going to defend against SK Telecom's Dragon pressure? They have a very fed Kalista here.
Yeah.
SKT is going to look to close this game by repeatedly fighting around the Dragon and trying to secure it. So that means H2K, they need Dragon Vision because their pick comp has to intercept SK Telecom on the way to that objective.
Yeah, to me, H2K would want to wait as long as possible on that and only contest the fifth Dragon. Unless they can
bold.
Get... Honestly, that is the way European teams or North American teams have generally dealt with the Dragon Snowball. They wait until the last minute, hope to turn the game around before that point, and if they can't, then they fight exactly on the fifth Dragon, and it works much better than in other regions. So, for instance, in the LCK or the LMS, oh, there might be a fight coming into the mid lane. I'll get to it.
That could be, yep. Garnet slowed down a little bit. Teleport's coming in for SK Telecom. Varen gets it with a big apprehend. They're going to get flayed as they try to chase down Kasing, and Lulax, Ryu on the run already, going to turn around for a little bit of damage. Kasing goes down. There's another kill for Varen. Second of the game, and a good fight for SK Telecom taking out that bot lane.
Varen instantly flash apprehended after TPing in right there because he knew he was going to have to deal with the slow coming in from the box. So really setting up that play well, getting the deep ward in so they had a teleport target.
Yeah, SKT might actually be at the point where they can apply Baron pressure on top of the Dragon Snowball because they're now at a 5,000 gold lead. But while it may not be super relevant to this game, basically, LCK teams, when they're up 4-0, and LMS teams in Dragons, are like a 95% win rate. But North American and EU teams, when they're up 4-0, is more around a 70% win rate, only because the LCK and LMS teams don't let it get to that point at 4-0. So if they're going to lose, they usually lose contesting the third or the fourth Dragon rather than the fifth.
Yeah, I mean, once you're on that four Dragon pressure, you basically need to win the team fight or you're done, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a very risky situation to be in. H2K, though, losing a lot more than that Dragon game so far. Down 5 turrets to 3, and it is a 6,000 gold lead in 22 minutes, too, which is pretty substantial.
Looks like SKT maybe just be happy to play a little bit further back and wait this one out until the next Dragon fight, not really leaving themselves open to many kills. And now with the ward line, there aren't very many deep wards in for H2K, so you know, they have the vision control. Yep. They're just staying on their half of the map and waiting for the drag.
It feels like H2K has recovered from the flurry of action that H2K unleashed right after the pause. Before SKT actually made those nice plays in the mid lane, H2K did have deep ward lines into the red jungle as well, so that was a play they had set up, and essentially H2K's momentum has been broken.
Yeah.
They now need to have almost a lucky play in order to get back into this game, because they have to go into unvisioned territory against an Evelynn and Karthus, which is really, really dangerous.
Yeah, the setup already coming through from SK Telecom. You see Bakken getting 3 pink wards, waiting about a minute left before they push forward onto that objective. H2K with plenty of wards in the inventory too, though. The battle for vision will be incoming.
And the question is, I mean, with SK Telecom already having that vision advantage, you know, will H2K even really be able to get in and contest too much?
Yeah, they're going to try and just make sure, cover their bases, not let the Baron go here either.
Yeah.
We get some vision around that. Morin going back for one last recall.
H2K is playing off of their teleport advantage right now. They need to get Ottawamne up a little bit more.
Oh, Bengi has a flash.
They're going to catch him.
Oh, he got gold carded. He got CC'd to death. And Kasing with the kill there. Meanwhile, more action as Ottawamne tries to engage onto SK Telecom. Wolf pulled in with that Fates Call, thrown back in again. But SKT with not a lot of follow-up. Wolf may not have wanted to go in there. There's a knock-up onto Ottawamne. Ezihun looking for some opportunities, putting down some Qs, and Marin just can't get in there. He needs to run. Ottawamne flashing, banging a little bit of trouble. There's more damage coming in from Ryu.
Bang, oh, now they're inside Karthus.
Lulex taking a lot of damage, and Karthus doing so much. Here comes a Requiem. Can he get any more? Gets one onto Kasing at the end of all of that. So it looks like it's going to be 2-for-1 in favor of SKT.
That's the second time this game that I think that H2K is really overextended for a play. The first one was responding to the tower dive in the bottom side. They had the advantage right there. They got the pick. Go ahead, stop the Dragon Snowball.
H2K has the right idea with so many of these plays. They had a teleport advantage, which meant they were kind of looking for a fight the instant that Darius showed on the other side of the map. But they got the Bengi pick
essentially for free. They didn't need to then burn their teleport advantage and then force a slow fight up the mid lane, because if they just got the Bengi pick, they could have maintained their teleport advantage, kept split push pressure, and then actually forced a 4v3 with the threat of a 5v3. Instead, they just opted into a 5v4 after they got the initial pick.
Yeah, I mean, now it's starting to look like the desperation is setting in for H2K a little bit here, as SK Telecom takes their third Dragon in a row, really monopolizing the objective. This time, monopolizing the vision too.
It's also, don't run into a Karthus.
Under turret.
Under turret. Don't do that. It's one of those things. Now, we don't see very much Karthus played professionally these days, so sometimes you, as a team, have to readjust to how you play against a particular champion. But Karthus is getting scary now. His Rod is maxed out in terms of stacks, has the Abyssal Scepter, and now he's starting to go into some more needlessly large Rods. And he, of course, is going to be a monster in the late game if you give him that opportunity.
Uh-oh.
And the scary thing, too, is the scarier Karthus gets, if he hits one ult, Marin can just pentakill them.
The scarier Darius gets as well.
Scariest. That's what you call him now. Maybe not right now, but soon. Maybe after he gets a few more kills.
Resetting champions are just tremendous with Karthus. Karthus has kind of fallen so far out of meta that you don't see it that often, but the synergy is absolutely massive. The amount of upfront damage he can do, even if he just flashes into a teamfight, dies and ults, is almost enough to set up Marn for just one Q ultimate and then start the reset chain.
Yeah, I mean, when you've got champions like Renekton, Gragas, Thresh all going in, you're going to be sitting right on top of that Karthus if the team groups up on him.
I think we have to ask, too, how much more Karthus are we going to see this tournament in a meta where assassins are not very prevalent? And,
well, Bengi, big ult on the H2K as they try to disengage. Nice, Wolf throws himself in there right under Ryu. Ryu in trouble, shut down for Karthus, and they're continuing to push ahead. Marin comes in with a nice two-man apprehend, a big Q onto Kasing and Yharnam, and Yharnam in a lot of trouble after support goes down. SK Telecom tears apart H2K, and they're about to tear apart that Baron, too.
It's another time Marin comes in with a really strong flash apprehend, and another play that is generated in the mid lane for SKT. H2K, all their plays have been about side lane control, but SKT is then attacking where H2K is weak. Ryu cannot teleport to stop a fight if he started on the fight, and now Lulex, he's trying to be a miracle maker, but there's no way.
Wants to be the hero, but it's not going to get close enough, as SKT takes a pretty easy Baron. Lulex on the run now. We'll see if he gets out. He might be able to get himself executed in time.
I think that's the hope of
this day.
Slow him down.
Yeah, he slowed him a little bit.
But I think there's another friend coming.
Here comes Marin! Pulls him in! And a little bit of flare before he goes down. That's something at least, right?
So my point about Karthus. Low assassin meta. Teleport's very common. And you can follow, quote-unquote, people's teleports with that ultimate. And we're going to take a look at this fight again.
Exactly. Ryu was up pretty far to try and keep the wave pushed, and it's also due to the lack of deep vision. H2K didn't have any idea there was the whole team running down the mid lane. They had no idea where anyone on SKT was, so really a positional error by Ryu there, and the rest is SKT just capitalizing and coming in with the big flank. No team at Worlds has been able to capitalize on opponent missteps as well as SKT.
And now they've got the Baron, so that solves some of their issues when it comes to setting up some of these sieges. So their composition is very well known for. Ryu there has to take the exit via the gate. A little bit worried after getting pushed out of the mid lane.
And he should be. Here comes Marin, blocked off by those flame chompers. You know, he didn't even need to use his teleport to get that flank last fight, so he still has that available. It's pretty scary as SKT moves into the mid lane, trying to take out that inhibitor turret.
Yeah. Baron buff and an Alistar, so not only do they get a long time to take down the turrets, if they do want to die, if they can get the aggro onto Alistar, the reduced damage will be able to reduce the turret damage, which normal tanks can't do since the turret has 85% armor penetration. Straight damage reduction can get around that.
Well, for now, SKT held off. The wave clear is pretty good for H2K. Ryu can handle a lot of that, even if it is a Baron buff, but it seems like it's only a matter of time. And a minute 30 till Dragon comes back into. Oh, there's a Requiem. SK Telecom going in. They want the turret. They're going to burn the Karthus ult to get it. And they will get it. Wolf comes in, takes a lot of damage. He's going to pop his ult just in time as SK Telecom chasing down H2K.
Bang!
The damage from Bang is insane right now. Double kill. Can he get more? Triple kill. I believe he may have. No, now Quadra yet. As Lulex and Odor Omni still alive, but Doesn't really matter. I think SKT's ready to end this one.
Beautifully executed play there, pushing them off the turret with EasyHoon, and then when H2K thought it was safe to come back in, that's when Wolf attacked.
That's right, and the attack is successful. The Nexus turrets go down. There goes the Nexus, and SK Telecom will close it out just shy of 30 minutes. It's another win for SKT. They're 5-0 in the group now.
Yeah, sets them up for a pretty solid first place performance in this group stage.
Yeah.
And now we have to turn and see H2K. You know, they fell behind early. They had that unfortunate death at level one, which set Ryu really far behind. But honestly, credit to them. I think they actually played out that mid game quite well, considering the deficit.
They really did.
SKT is on their way to a 6-0 group and has looked very dominant in this group. But for their games in particular, H2K has been much harder to beat than EDG was.
I think H2K has the best games against their poor record in this tournament right now. They've been losing a lot, but their losses, they've still looked fairly good at certain points in them.
Yeah, H2K has had the right idea on a lot of plays. I do have to talk briefly on SKT here, though. They are on their way to a 6-0 group if they can defeat the Bangkok Titans at the very last game of the day.
Seems pretty likely.
And I wonder, last year there was so much talk about Samsung White and whether they could get the perfect run at Worlds. Well, currently, SKT, they might be going for that title as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're going to go for it as long as they can, I suppose. And with that win, too, I believe SKT does lock up first place in the group with a 5-0. No one can do that.
Mathematically confirmed this time.
Mathematically confirmed. There we go. A little bit of math.
No one else can get to five wins.
That's right.
They have beaten everyone too many times for that.
And SKT, I mean, EasyHoon, it didn't seem like they really missed a beat, really, did they? I mean, the Karthus, such a different pick than we usually see from Faker, but they really were able to sort of integrate it into their team style very, very easily. Yeah. And that's what SK Telecom does. I mean, why not? So now we're going to send it over to the analyst desk for a little bit of a post-game recap.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now, very necessary win there for SKT in order to secure that first round, or rather first seed going into the bracket stages. But we're going to take this opportunity before we get into our next game to check in with the Twitter sphere, where you guys are sending in your questions for our resident Season 3 World Championship finalists with the hashtag AskTabe. Now we'll start with a tweet from @Bachiak, which says, what do you do to prepare for a big match? Well, Tabe, what is it?
Before we are going to face a huge enemy, our opponents, before a big match, we will have a very in-depth conversation with our teammates. We will have a meeting about like 30 to 60 minutes about the band pick. We will stimulate the picks from our enemies. For example, if our enemies are SKT, we will think of them, of what will Faker going to pick, what will Marine was going to pick. Mm. And after that, we will think of the team morale. Are we very afraid of against them, and we will choose to have a big meal to relax ourselves.
Sounds good.
Gotta have that big meal, fill up your stomachs.
Food.
Exactly, yeah, get your minds off of the game itself. Next up, we have Loki259, who writes, which team has the best bot lane at Worlds currently?
I think the first seed of China, LGD, has the best bot lane in the Worlds. Although they didn't perform very good in the Worlds, they lost three games already. But I think Imp and PYL are the best of the best.
And I want to ask you, because we hear a lot about PYL, but what makes PYL such a great support in your mind?
Because my play when I was a player too, I like aggressive play. And I think the best two supports in China is Miko and PYL. But I think PYL is playing much more aggressive than Miko. And comparing the two bot lanes, Deft plus Miko and Imp plus PYL, I think they are more convincing.
Yeah, I have to agree with LGD bot lane, because it's very hard to look beautiful when you're dancing in the mud.
And I want to add something about being aggressive in bot lane. If you play very aggressively in bot lane, your opponent will think, oh, B, because there's jungler behind you. Mm. It's just nonsense. There's no jungler behind you. It's just simply we are aggressive. Mm. It's like very good play.
MPYL have been shining lights for a team that is struggling quite seriously in this tournament so far. Next up, Aturgis wants to know, what is more important in advancing at Worlds, innovation or one solid strategy? What are your thoughts there?
I think of a long, long time to answer this question, because I think innovation is the most important thing. And the second thing is the understanding of your teammates. Why? Why I invented Ani support is because in our team, we have Uzi for huge damage output, and we have White as a very good AP in China. But we have a huge problem. Who is going to initiate? We have huge problems about initiation, and we have a meeting of a whole team, and we figure out that Sona and Fresh is the best initiators. But then I ask my questions. Let me list all about the champions who have stuns. We figure about Sion, we have Anivia, and I suddenly think, oh, what am I doing? Annie has the best AoE stun in the world, because before the patches now, there are a lot of nerfs on Annie, you know?
Yep.
And that time, Annie have 1.75 second stun, even in level 1. And about this question, why innovation is important, I explained about thinking of what is the best hero during this patch. And the second thing is, you have to understand your teammates. I know that Uzi always blame about no initiations. We always know that White or even Godlike can make good initiations. So you have to have good understanding of your team.
Can you go too far? Like PYL pick Brand, for example. Do you think that is an example of bad innovation in a meta where Brand didn't really do that good?
Because I have emphasized that Mordekaiser is very afraid of stun and silence. Maybe I think he picks Brand is because of the synergy between Brand and Kalista. Kalista can ulti Brand into the face tanking Mordekaiser and EQ immediately. But it's after you are level 6. When you are level 6, Mordekaiser is already level 8.
Yeah.
I think it is not his problem of picking Brand, but it is the problem of the coach. Why you are having Mordekaiser in other people's team.
Right, so innovation around a team based on the information you have about your teammates. Finally, from Reckoner Celeste, Tabe, who do you think is the top support champion right now at Worlds?
I think this question is the same as the first question. The first thing you have to know is you have to have a very good understanding of the current patch. And the second thing is you have to have always be innovative. For example, we have seen Kench support used by Gorilla. He is just ultiing and he eats Jinx and he brought Prey into 5 men. And he uses W to rescue your ADC. Why he uses this is because no one understands about Kench. No one has the same in-depth understanding of Gorilla's Kench. For my opinion, among the world's play, I think Morgana will be a very good pick because we can see by stats that Morgana has won all the games as a support, but there's only a single lose time when Morgana is used by Pobelta as a mid lane.
Something that I would like to add as well, simply because top lane and mid has been so important to last pick, that's why we have to see these blind pick supports all the time. Otherwise, we would see these counter picks. That's why we don't see Janna, that's why we don't see any Soraka or any kind of innovative picks. That's why we get to see these boring like blind picks like Alistar and Braum.
Well, Tom Kench is not boring.
Yeah, Tom Kench is...
I'm hoping to see more Tom Kench. I want Tom Kench to become meta in this tournament. Well, Tabe, thank you very much for providing us with some of that insight there. We'll see if H2K can shake off that loss as they get back on stage for our next match where they'll face the LPL's Edward Gaming. Keep it tuned right here. We'll be back after this.
Here comes Marin as well. Flash from Bengi. I don't think that's going to be enough damage. Oh, and Bengi taken out by Ryu. Requiem coming in. Teleport coming into that turn. The bot lane as well, too. Wolf gets stopped up for a second. Darnit stays alive for the moment. Had to use not the summoner hero quite yet. Bengi.
Oh, now they're inside Karthus.
Lulek's taking a lot of damage, and Karthus doing so much. Here comes a Requiem. Can he get any more? As SK Telecom chasing down H2K.
Bang.
The damage from Bang is insane right now. Double kill. Can he get more? Triple kill. It's another win for SKT. They're 5-0 in the group now.